Hey there, and welcome to Play Noggin. I'm Julian, your brain's player too. Few characters embody the 90s like Sonic the Hedgehog. At the time of the first Sonic game's release, he oozed more attitude than any game character before him. I mean, come on, did you want to play as a chubby plumber in overalls or a way past cool hedgehog with rad red sneakers? Probably, the choice wasn't up to you. You got the mascot of whichever console your parents bought for you. But for Sega kids in the 90s, Sonic was the best. Sonic's whole thing is his speed. The opening song of the good Sonic the Hedgehog cartoon makes the claim that he's the fastest thing alive. Yeah, I called it the good one. Come at me, bro. Now, in reality, hedgehogs aren't known for their speed. In fact, they top out at around 10 kilometers per hour, and even then, they only achieve that speed in short bursts. They do roll up into little balls to protect themselves, but it's not for spin dashing, because their quills would catch in the ground and keep them from going anywhere. And in the wild, foxes prey on hedgehogs. Sure, Tails might look adorable, but he's making plans. Dinner plans. Stop following me, you little monster. Anyway, let's assume that he is the fastest thing alive, except for when Eggman is making his escape. Then he must be faster than the real-world record holder, the Peregrine Falcon, which tops out at over 320 kilometers per hour. Maybe that's not a fair comparison, since the Falcon hits ludicrous speeds thanks to gravity and amazing aerodynamics, while Sonic's gotta do it by pounding pavement. The fastest thing running is, of course, the Cheetah, which can clock in at 120 kilometers per hour in short bursts. If we want to be even more generous, we can say Sonic is the fastest thing on 2 feet, beating out the ostrich's top speed of over 97 kilometers per hour. Of course, he's named Sonic because he's supposed to be able to run at the speed of sound, which is 1,225 kph, at sea level. It gets slower with altitude though, because sound travels through air, and when it gets thinner, the speed of sound drops. You may have noticed I'm meandering a bit, and that's sort of the point. Sonic's speed has been done to death, and you'll get 100 different answers depending on who you ask or what game you play. Players who have measured his height and compared it to the time it takes to complete a level report he only runs 36 kph, but he's been different heights in the same game. The game claims he can run at the speed of light provided he's wearing the right shoes, which is impossible IRL, regardless of how fabulous your footwear. So rather than muddle through all that, we wanted to narrow the focus a bit and look at how Sonic's speed relates to how he handles loop-de-loops. Admit it, when you were a kid playing Sonic 1 for the first time, the moment Sonic flew down a hill and up and around a loop, you lost your prepubescent mind. It's nothing to be ashamed of. The human body was not built to handle the Sega Genesis's blast processing. We take it for granted that Sonic, moving as fast as he does, could easily clear a loop like that. But what sorts of physical laws are at play to make that possible? Whether it's Sonic or a toy car or a real car, it's amazing to watch something do the loop-de-loop because our experience tells us that at the top of the loop, it should just fall down. That's the point where gravity is pulling on Sonic and the track has flipped from supporting him to working against him. So just what's keeping him up there? You may have heard the term centrifugal force used to explain what keeps objects from falling down, but it turns out, like the blue sphere, it doesn't really exist. Sure, if you've ever ridden on a roller coaster through a loop, it feels like something is pulling you outward, but it's an illusion. If the roller coaster car were to suddenly derail, it would shoot off tangentially to the loop before horribly killing you, because objects have a property called inertia, and when they're in motion, they tend to travel in a straight line unless acted upon by an outside force. That outside force pulling you in towards the middle of the loop is called centripetal force, and in the case of the roller coaster or Sonic's loop, it's provided by the track. Combine inertia and centripetal force, and to the object in the loop, it feels like something is pulling it outward, away from the center of the circle. That's the apparent force, known as centrifugal force. Still, you can use this apparent force to calculate just how fast Sonic would need to travel to avoid being a spiky splat on the ground below. Up there, gravity is pulling him downward, and assuming he's on Earth, it's doing it at about 9.8 meters per second squared. So Sonic has to be traveling fast enough at that point that at the very least, the force of gravity would make him travel in a curve that's the same radius as the loop-de-loop. The formula for that equation is velocity equals the square root of gravitational acceleration times the length of that radius. Since gravity is always going to be more or less the same, that means that Sonic's speed for successful loopage is dependent on the radius of the loop, and the bigger the loop, the faster he needs to go. Though it doesn't scale linearly. If he were in a loop with a 5-meter radius, he would have to be going 7 meters per second at the height of the loop. If he ran in a circle with twice the radius, 10 meters, he wouldn't have to run twice as fast, but just under 10 meters per second when he hit the apex. It's important to note that at that speed, he would start losing traction because he'd be going just barely fast enough to stay on the track. So to be safe, he'd have to run a little faster to keep his feet planted. And he'd need a higher entry speed because he'd lose some when he started going uphill and had to fight the force of gravity on his way up. Keep that in mind if you're going to try this at home. Also, don't try this at home, just play Sonic instead, or ride a roller coaster or something. Of course, a roller coaster isn't a perfect comparison. They're clamped onto the track, so even if it doesn't have enough speed to make it around the loop, worst case scenario, you get stuck upside down while you wait for rescue and the lunch you just ate to show up. Not comfortable, but better than plummeting to your death. While you're up there, you might notice that the loop is not a perfect circle like the loops in the Green Hill Zone. They're slightly more tear-shaped, as though they've been pinched at the top. These are known as clothoid loops, and they have some advantages over perfectly circular loops. Because the initial curve has a longer radius, riders don't feel as many G's on the gentler curve. And because the radius at the top of the loop is much smaller, the car doesn't have to travel as fast to clear it. It also means that the car can have a lower entry speed because it won't have to climb up such a high loop. And you want that as a rider because a coaster car, unlike Sonic, doesn't have a way to propel itself. Still, if you need to feel like a hyper-fast bolt of blue, a roller coaster is the closest thing to being Sonic the Hedgehog most of us are ever going to get, unless we dust off the old Sega Genesis. Hey, thanks for watching. If you like this video, be sure to like and subscribe. If you want to see more of our good stuff, go ahead and check out some of these other videos we've made for you right here. And don't forget to keep on playing.